All right, quiet down, you people. We so much want to thank you for coming today to be with us. Thank you for supporting the VersoFest in general. And my name is Christine Ohlman. I'm really, really happy to be here today to present this very special segment. Thank you. Thank you. Yay! We're here today for the Oral History Project. Emphasis on the word history. And my guest is such an important and crucial part of that in an ongoing way for all of American popular culture. She's truly a Renaissance woman, a musician, an archivist, a collector, a historian, a book publisher, it just goes on and on, one of the curators of a fabulous insider-outsider record label, and through it all, a writer. She's absolutely a keeper of the flame, Miriam Linna.
Thank you, Christine.
All right.
That's quite a list of accolades.
Yeah, it is. Well, it's all true.
I'm not sure how deserving I am, but I appreciate it.
Absolutely, baby. And we only have a little over an hour, so forgive us if we speed through some parts. There'll be a 15-minute Q&A afterwards. There's a microphone over there, because VersoFest, as you know, chugs along all day, and Miriam will be available for meet and greet at her table with the record and book fair in the back of the library later on, so you can talk to her back there as well. Yeah. The music clips in particular, and I apologize, will be quick. So take some notes, look them up in their entirety later, or go to the fabulous Norton Records website, where everything we're showing today is available on the website for perusal or, of course, for sale. So we'll be focusing on some truly pivotal artists in Miriam's life. So everybody ready?
Yeah.
All right, let's buckle up.
Okay.
Here she is. So we're going to start, Miriam, with your first big love. There you are, giant, right? So big, yeah. The Flaming Groovies, and then circle back a little bit. Your writing career really gets started as a fangirl letter writer.
Right.
You're born in Sudbury, Ontario, moved to Ohio in the seventh grade, graduate high school in 72, and in 73, at age 17, you and your dear sister Helen go to the UK and visit the UK.
That's
and
right.
Then, yeah. And then it kind of moves on from there pretty quickly, because back in Ohio, you enter Kent State, and you become immersed in the Cleveland scene, which even at the time was very rich. It had been the home, of course, of the radio god Alan Freed before he moved to New York. And now in the present day, of course, it's the home of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Why do you think Cleveland has such a special place in American rock and roll?
Well, it was a total wasteland. And there was nothing going on apart from radio. Mm-hmm. And at that time that I was really involved with stuff, which was in the early 70s,
yeah,
it was really difficult for anybody to be their own person, to invent something new. And the people that I got involved with, the people that I really admired, were, I guess, the strugglers, but they were the ones who were making the great noise. So I've always been attracted to the noise, and that's what happened.
Yeah, Rockin' for the Tombs, Para Ubu, the Dead
That's
Boys.
Right. Yeah.
Of course, they were your, you know, some of your particular loves.
Yeah, especially Rockin' from the Tombs and the Electric Eels also at that time. And the Mirrors were around at that time.
Yeah.
But these were all groups who were playing, you know, unglorified to some very small groups of people. I mean, you know, sometimes a dozen people, sometimes less,
sure.
You know, at the Viking Saloon or wherever, you know, but playing as though they were playing in a stadium. And it didn't matter. It didn't matter that there were a few people there. What mattered was the sound.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you begin writing about music and record collecting, and here's you and your friend Becky. You're on your way to a Rockin' to the Tombs show.
Yeah.
And you begin your career, if I may say, as an archivist of the American dream. That's really the way I look at it, at least from a rock and roll standpoint. I hope that's okay.
Yeah, that's okay. Thank you.
And you hook up with the ferocious San Francisco garage band, the Flamin' Groovies.
That's absolutely right.
The Groovies.
Yeah.
Your letter, so this is, you said this to me, your letter writing and fanzine flipping out leads you to Bomp Records and Hoop with the Bomp founder, Greg Shaw.
That's right.
who in 1976, pretty much as soon as you moved to New York, turns over a box of badges, the Groovies fan club, and their fan magazine, the Flaming Groovies Monthly, to you, Miriam Linna, fangirl.
Yes.
So, again, what attracts you in particular to the Groovies? What was it about them?
Teenage monster.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
The whole idea that, you know, you're making a racket, and they made such a joyful noise as well. They felt like the underdogs to me, and I've always been in the corner of the underdogs. I always felt like underdoggerism, if there is such a thing, is the place to be, because it's the people who don't get the accolades who I want to give the accolades to. I mean, you know, I love the Rolling Stones. I love the Beatles. I love the Yardbirds. I love Elvis and all of that stuff.
Yeah.
But they've got the props. It's the people who need the props, and that's been the call all along.
Yeah. Well, just to prove her point, Groovies fans, raise your hands. Yeah, see, I knew it. We have unearthed, Miriam gave this to us actually. This is a 1972 TV clip of the Flamin' Groovies doing Slow Death. And I have to say, you know, I'm a musicologist. I have rarely seen anything as good as this.
Yes.
I have rarely seen anything as good as this. So enjoy, everybody. Here they come, the Flamin' Groovies, Slow Death.
Yeah.
Turn it up.
Way up.
Way up.
Woo! Ah!
Oh, no, I'm sorry. No, keep going.
She's just going wild.
I'm so sorry. We play every single cut. We'd be here for 3 hours. But you see what we're talking about here. And, you know, it's funny you raised the word underdog now, because we're actually going to circle back to that at the very end of our time together today.
Okay.
But I think that's one of the most important things about your work and Billy's work as we go on now and talk about all the different things that you did together. All right? So your life as a writer really hinges in the beginning on fanzines. It's all about fanzines. And you'd become one of the loves of your life, and eventually would lead straight to Kicks magazine. And more about that in a minute. But from the start, you said to me, in quotes, "I was doing it for love, for the losers in Cleveland and the losers in New York City." Yeah. Yes.
Long live the losers.
We probably have some New York City losers here with us today. I'm one. All right. And you said that your letter writing morphed into fanzines. So, and of course, before the internet, fanzines were huge. I think you have some for sale at the table, and enormous part of American rock and roll culture. So you begin your life in earnest after some encouragement from the writer and the critic, Lester Bangs. He sends you a letter, which was very, very pivotal. Now, how did this inspire you?
Well, before that even, there was Greg Shaw, Alan Betrock, and Tom Hosier, also from New Haven here, who was a correspondent and a fanzine writer as well. But the whole idea was that, you know, we felt like such loners and square pegs, that these people who I held in high regard, because they actually were published and were on the newsstands in the estimation of Lester, that they took the time to respond and then to become friends. And that pivotal letter that you're talking about, I just got permission to reprint it in a little chapbook memoir that I'm going to be doing. Mm-hmm. 8-page letter of such incredible attitude regarding loving rock and roll, doing what you feel, talking about what you want, and so on, with the music. And Lester never wrote like anybody else. I mean,
yeah,
when you were reading
right.
him in Pages of Cream or whatever, everybody else was talking like a rock journalist. This whole expression of rock journalism, take it, put it on a rocket and send it to Mars, the dark side of the planet.
That's
because the fandom is so leached out of there because
right.
of the whole idea of proper writing and so on.
Yeah.
But he could get you on the ledge. He could get you to buy anything
That's
with
right.
the attitude that he had about writing. And he was my hero.
That's
you know,
right.
we had
yeah.
our extreme ups and downs there.
Yeah.
But to this day, when it comes to rock and roll writing, he is the man.
Perfect. All right, so you become a writer for New York Rocker. You start working for record man Marty Thau. And as you said, you become what you're a fan of.
That's right.
And nobody shows this, nobody's life in rock and roll shows this better than you because life imitates art because on Bicentennial Day, July 4th, 1976, you move to New York City from Ohio.
Yep.
Before that, when you were still enrolled at Kent State, you had a short trip where you had met Ivy and Lux of the Cramps. You had never played drums, but within 3 months, you're behind a kit at Max's Kansas City and CBGB. So you've described your biggest thrill as opening for the Ramones.
Yeah, absolutely. But the very first date was actually the first date of the Dead Boys at CBGB's.
At CB's, yeah.
Yeah, and the band, the Cramps, was actually listed as an unlisted group. So we weren't even credited on it. But that didn't last for long. It was like immediately afterward there was more action going on.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
that's where it started. But the biggest thrill was opening for the Ramones. And we ended up opening many times for them, and that was just as good as it got. To me, the Ramones were seeing them for the first time in Youngstown, Ohio, mm-hmm. when that was probably the furthest west that they had gone,
mm-hmm.
was like seeing, for me, you know, as trite as it might sound to other people, it was like seeing the Beatles for me.
Of course.
Because you're
yeah.
you're like up close and here's these guys.
Yeah.
And I just admired them so much
yeah.
and became close friends with them. And to be able to play, to be able to perform and play the drums, you know, in a band before them was actually
yeah.
a bigger thrill than anything playing in yeah. front of anybody else or playing headlining for anybody else.
Yeah.
That moment was spectacular.
Well, you're preachers to the choir here. This is really a New York group, right? The Ramones, everybody, for Pete's sake. Yeah. All right, we have a clip. We have a clip of you playing with the Cramps. Here you are pounding away on the drums. Here we go. Here we go.
Oh, okay.
It's the teen beat.
Hi-fi.
Woo-hoo! Well, there, yeah.
Oh, pshaw.
Remember I said we were going to move quickly, and we are. Okay, now things start to get interesting. You're with the Cramps, and then in the fall of 1977, you joined Nervous Rex.
That's right, and we have among our midst right now, I see Lauren Agnelli, Trixie A-Bomb.
Really? Hey, all right.
Of the Nervous Rex right there.
Yeah. And then that's because in 1977, you meet Billy Miller.
That's right.
Yes.
October 3rd, 1977.
That's right.
Yeah.
You go to I'm shocked to know that you were at a record fair when this happened. And it has an actual little tie-in to the Smithereens, who were here Friday night.
Yes, it was.
It starts with a song called It Must Be a Witch by the Lollipop Shop. We're going to listen to that in a minute. But tell us what happened. You're at a record fair. There's Billy.
This is the first record fair that I've ever been at. You know, before that, I've always been shopping at the Salvation Army or, you know, the bargain bins or whatnot. But this was the first record fair and going around to these tables, just like people are out there now today. But going around to the tables, and I was looking for this one particular record, and I happened to go up to Billy's table. I went up to everybody's table,
mm-hmm.
and I asked them for that. And you know, before he answered me, he goes, "Hey, you're the girl from the Flame and Groovies fan club." And I thought, what? You know, and at the time, you know, I was publishing, you know, this little rag that possibly, you know, 50 copies were ever out there,
yeah.
and just a few at Bleeker Bob's, and he had picked it up there at the Bleeker Bob record shop, and somehow
yeah.
recognized my photo from a little, you know, Xerox
yep.
kind of
yep.
a photo
yeah.
in there.
Yeah.
So I was impressed.
Yes, well, maybe he was looking for you.
Yeah.
Can we hear just a little clip? This is You Must Be a Witch by the Lollipop Shop, that fateful record. Oh, I love them. I want all of those outfits. I want every one of those outfits. So Billy's with the Zantees, and you leave Nervous Rex, and you join Billy's newly formed combo, the A-Bones, who, as we all know, would have tons of records and, you know, EPs and LPs. And later on, you'll play drums on Maureen Tucker's solo album,
yes,
Under Stress, in 1994. And also, you'll go solo in 2014 on Norton. You'll have two records of your own under the name Miriam, right?
Yeah, Lena. Produced by Sam Elwitt.
Yeah.
Who was a genius.
Yes, yes. And sort of, and you went... kind of delved into the girl group sound then a little bit on those records, a little
yeah,
bit.
I somehow Sam, you know, heard that in my vocalizing earlier and said, hey, let's pick some of your favorite songs and do a recording. We did a single and then we went on from that.
Yeah, yeah. Nothing better than the girl groups.
Yeah.
You and Billy are together for 39 years, becoming one of the most important couples in archiving, preserving, and illuminating the work of some of the most unique artists in all of American popular culture. I said it. I
wow.
said it.
Thank you, Christine.
Yeah. And in 1979, things begin to heat up, and you and I talked a lot getting ready for this, and we kept using the word synchronicity, that different things kept happening on top of other things that just seemed sort of fated to happen. And your love of fanzines leads you to something called Kix Magazine. You decide that, Billy says, to get all your friends to enthuse and gather. Those were his words, right? And, you know, before the internet, remember when you found your tribe? Remember when you found your musical tribe, everybody? Was it a blues tribe? Was it a garage band tribe? For me, it was a soul music tribe. You know, it was hard to do back then, and magazines were one of the biggest things to help you
That's right.
to do that. So let's talk about a guy, the first person that you end up wanting to spotlight, and this leads to a whole career of spotlighting people, is a cat from West Virginia named Hazel Atkins.
Yes, indeed.
Yes, right? Out to hunch, baby. So... you end up going looking for him, right? And Billy says, why don't you try to find him? So what happens?
Well, yeah. He ended up being found by Don Folletti. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's right.
He ended up being found by Don Folletti, who was one of our idols in a vocal groupdom. And
here he is with some of his women up here. Yeah.
There we are with Hazel early on.
Miriam.
We've got Todd Abramson here in the audience, who was pivotal in going out there and daring into the West Virginia hills with Billy
yeah.
to retrieve Hazel at one point. But he was a genius. He was a one-man band, and we never intended to start a label at all. You know,
right.
it was all
right.
out of this Kix Magazine article where people
right.
were saying, what does this guy sound like?
Right.
And we started asking around. Don was the one who located him. He had no real interest in a hillbilly guy, so he passed them on to us. We contacted him and were able to bring him into the fold. And for many years, he was pretty much exclusively a Norton artist, although he's been recorded and released all around the world.
Yeah, yeah, he had a little thing called Chicken Walk.
Yeah.
And we're going to play you a few minutes of that right now. This is the great Hazel Atkins doing the walk, everybody.
Come on, baby, I should have. Come on, baby, I should have. We'll do it hard, we'll do it fast. We'll do it hard, we'll do it fast. Come on, baby, I should have.
Lorenzo. Yes, yeah. Everybody. And this was supposed to be a one-off. It was, you thought you were going to put out one record, right?
That's right. That's
but
right.
Instead, synchronicity swoops in, and Norton Records is born. And as yeah. you've said, whose big idea? You said this is like a real corporate decision to start this.
Yeah. Well, what happened with it, with we got a lot of flack at first with the Hazel album, you know, like, what is this, you know?
Yeah.
It's like kind of a thing, but we got an article very early on by a fellow who was the writer at Stereophile. And Stereophile, you know, the audiophile magazine and so on.
Perfect.
He wrote his last review.
Yeah.
He heard the album, picked it up because he saw that it was, you know, an interesting looking record, picked it up, listened to it, and wrote an article that said, I'll never write again because I have heard the Pitch Perfect album, the That's best it. Recording of anything. And Hazel was recording on the cheesiest kind of a system that you could ever imagine on the tightest budget, no budget,
yeah.
and with a lot of commodity cheese involved. So,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
And here this guy wrote this, and that really, it did turn the page for us, you know. It that article really brought in some people who didn't dare say, you know, you're putting out, you know, music that doesn't belong to be right. heard by human ears.
Right. And I just want to point out too that this also starts a great history with you of fabulous covers, fabulous graphics, many of which are reproduced on stickers, and you know, it's just an amazing. Of you know, the question mark and the Mysterians alone is one of the best covers I've ever seen. You know, so let's. I don't know who you're. What, did you have a graphic artist, or do you just do? You know, kind of.
We had a very small coterie of cover artists who worked yeah. for us at that time. Elizabeth Van Italy
yes.
is one of them. Who she designed the Gina Washington, the Siamese twins. She designed a whole heck of a lot of them.
Yeah.
You know, and Pete Chacon was great, yeah. and Pat Broderick. So these were people who you know, who were Norton. Album and 45 sleeve designers, right, and right. We were very happy to work with them. They were Nortonians and
yeah.
still are.
Beautiful. Because you also, at this point, you start your first mail order print catalog. So you figure there must be at least a small group of people that would want to know about this and would want to order stuff through the mail, which was the only way you could do it. And so that actually starts your outreach to your group, your tribe, your group of fans. Norton Records, where the loud sound abounds. It still is your motto.
Well, that was all mail order world at that time.
Right.
You know, it was before the internet and
right.
Before all of this. So the only way to really get the information out was that way. And there were a lot of other little small labels who
oh,
were
sure.
doing one-shot yeah. records, and they didn't have any way to get the information out. So
yeah.
we did it through that. We always wanted to promote the other labels that were like-minded and working in the same vein of the lost yeah. unknowns.
And now for the record collectors in the audience, which includes myself, we're going to focus on three Norton artists who are just, all of them pivotal in their own way. And the first one is the fabulous Escarita. You meet him in 83, 84, because again, going back to Kix magazine, you're gonna do an article
yeah.
on him for Kix.
Yeah.
And you discover that he is just an unbelievably unique artist. Although when you do hear the clip we're gonna play, those of you that don't know who he is, we'll see that he predates Little Richard, not the other way around. So he comes with, does he look familiar? You know, and Richard Penniman, who was, of course, brilliant in his own right, Little Richard Penniman, still has his very wonderful template, right?
Yeah.
To go for. And so where did you come, Vintage Vula, where did you come up with
That was Billy. He turned. He came up with this great title, and of course, that's been repeated over and over again.
Yeah.
And people just call him the Vula. He did do a record that was called the Vula, and where this operatic kind of a you know emphasized caterwauling that was rather operatic at the time,
yeah.
and that was really his thing. Just to say, you know, you're doing the comparison with Little Richard. There's a Little Richard documentary that is just out, and they came to us to feature an Escarita track and images in that because they wanted to bring that out. And Little Richard always wanted to as well.
Yes.
You know, he gave
yes,
the
he
props
did.
Where
yeah.
they were due, and the props were due to Escarita.
Absolutely. This is a clip now, an audio clip of Escarita rocking the joint. Check it out.
Now they were loving in the jungle, looking for
Absolutely amazing. Amazing. You found him.
Well,
you
it was very him. Lucky that that he happened to be back in New York after this long absence. So it's an incredible story, and we've ended up finding these even more amazing sounds after right after he passed away. These demos that he had cut in at Bell Sound, and we issued those as well. Amazing, you know, between gospel, rock and roll, rhythm and blues, soul, the whole thing. Escarita did it all, and his name is found on so many records, and people now just discovering that. And if you looked at a discography of the records that he was involved in, you know, you'd have to sit down with a long cup of coffee.
Absolutely. And I know you would, Miriam. Yeah, you love that coffee.
I do.
Our mutual friend, Cub Coda. Cub Coda ended up living here. My husband managed him for a while. They moved to New Hampshire, he and his wife, from Detroit. A huge part of the Norton family because, of course, he was a musicologist like you guys. Smoking in the boys' room with Brownsville Station when he would guess, when he would go out with the glasses and the big platform boots. But in the summer, he would play with Hound Dog Taylor. Yeah. He would morph into this completely different character, wedded to the Chicago blues. And talk a little bit about our friend for a minute.
Oh, Cub was just absolutely the best. I think about him every single day. His attitude was that, you know, eggheadism had to go. So when you're, so maybe it was something in the Michigan water. You know, I know that Lester was not from Michigan. He came from California to there. But he did imbibe in that liquid, that magic liquid that made people just say what they felt. And Cub's writing, of course, in Goldmine and other places, you know, was so enthusiastic and so infectious. And so was he. Yeah. He never, ever, ever tried to be, some kind of an esthete or somebody who was, a university guy, that you had to listen to or whatnot, footnotes and so on. He just was, and everybody knew that, and he was friends with so many different major artists from Bo Diddley on down. Yeah. Who loved them to pieces, and we loved them to pieces, too. Yeah. We were very thrilled to be able to issue his very earliest sites as the Deltinos, he had that voice from the time that he was a 14-year-old.
He really did. This is Cub now in blues mode, doing a Kid Thomas tune called Rockin' the Joint, and you pointed out that you... Norton had released the original of Rockin' the
Joint. Yeah, did the original. We had reissued the original version of it, and here, Cub was of course doing it. It's a nice little segue whatever you want to call it of the way the worlds collide and the synchronicity factor.
That's right. Here's Cub Coda, Rockin' the Joint. The Cub Master.
Yeah. The Cub Master.
Oh, wow. All right, and then ultra importantly, really, for so many reasons, you and Billy resuscitate the career of Link Wray. Link Wray. One of the most inventive guitarists in all of American popular music. And you go down a path of finding so many, you've five LPs, right? So many unreleased tracks. And in the end, you end up with his niece. Tell us about that a little bit.
Well, another moment of synchronicity in a story that just falls in with all of the different Norton chapters of our days was walking into a record store, of course. You know, everything happens at the record store. That's, I was at a particular record store in the East Village one day, years and years and years ago. One of the guys in the store says to me, Billy and I are both going through records, and one of the guys says to me, like, hey, there must be other link race stuff that's out there that hasn't been heard. And, you know, like, well, I don't know. It's like, he said, well, you know, you got to, well, you look. And this one particular record dealer who Billy wasn't that fond of didn't want to be talking to him. But he said to me, you know, do what you can for it. And, mm-hmm. of course, in those days, it was telephones. You know, there was right. no going on the into the research. And I took it upon myself because Billy said, look, if you really think there's anything out there, do it.
Yeah.
You know, so we had no idea that this pot of pure gold was going to be their musical gold.
Yeah.
What happened was Link Ray's niece, his brother Vernon's daughter, was the person that I first made contact with, and she said, my father said that somebody would call someday.
Oh.
And she had been left with a trunk of tapes. She didn't even know what was in the trunk yeah. at the time. Her father died suddenly of his own hand years before and had left this trunk, and she opened it one day, and on the top of it was a note that said, someday someone's going to care.
Oh.
And so she came to New York with the tapes, and what ended up happening is we released these several volumes of Link Ray, unissued material that was pretty spectacular and redefined kind of like the eras of Link Ray. Link was already so esteemed and revered for right. Rumble and so many other things, but this separated his sections into, you know, the hillbilly cat, you know, and then the biker guy,
yeah.
and all of these different facets, early facets of his life, and we were very, very proud to issue those records. Billy did a lot of hard work on those things, and it was wonderful working with Sherry Ray, who was the woman who came up with all this stuff. The one thing she asked us was, she said, you know, when you do these albums, please release the recordings of my brother. Her brother had died young, 14 years old, had drowned, and he had idolized Link. And I remember being in the studio with her, first listening to the recordings at Coyote Studios in Brooklyn, and she heard those recordings for the first time in so many years, and her brother is just saying to Link, hey, Uncle Link, you know, how do you play this thing? You know, it's like, and he's teaching, and it's the greatest album, Junior Rayman, yeah. you know, a short album of recordings, but it was essential for her to have her brother make it onto a vinyl record, and it's only on vinyl. So there you go.
This is what history is all about. Listen, yeah. I know you released a demo of Rumble, but we really couldn't get it to sound. We're going to just hear now a little of the hit version of Link Ray's Rumble. Okay. Never did three chords mean so much. The amazing Link Ray. So we're almost ready to exit all too quickly the wonderful world of Norton Records to move on. But before that, let's get synchronicity, as we're saying, into the next part of your journey with an artist named Andre Williams.
Yes, yes.
Andre Williams, Detroit soul man, had so many hits. And we are going to just right now, before we just talk about him, let's listen to a little of Andre Williams. This is his great song. I had the pleasure of playing this with him at Central Park Summer Stage, which was unbelievable. The Bacon Fat.
Oh,
Andre Williams. We're about to move now into the world of Kix books, and your entree is this man, Andre Williams. You discover that he's fallen on hard times. He's found living under a bridge in Chicago, and then something clicks with you when he goes into rehab. Tell us how he just leads into the next phase of your life.
Okay, well, just to give credit where credit is due, another collector, George Paulus, the late George Paulus of Chicago, who was a huge fan of rhythm and blues and blues and a major collector, great friend, was the person who found Andre under a bridge, living under a bridge in Chicago, and called us up and said, hey, listen, I want to take this guy back into the studio. Are you in with me? Like, we partnered up with it. We did the vinyl, and he did the CD at the time, and so Billy and I went for 10 days in Chicago and lived with George, and Dick Taylor of the Pretty Things and the Rolling Stones was brought in to play guitar on that. And we lived in the house together, and every day went into the studio. Andre would arrive somehow, miraculously, with some kind of a limousine or Cadillac, presenting him there, and dressed to the nines, absolutely dressed to the nines, and with a young kid in tow, who was apparently he was supposed to be babysitting for. So it was amazing. The Eldorados were brought in for the vocal group essence on that. Yeah. It was an amazing, amazing scene. To be able to see that, you know, we were absolutely, you know, gobsmacked and astounded to be in the presence of the great Andre Williams. And he ended up becoming a very close friend. The rehab story is that, you know, few albums in and many trips to rehab out of there, because he was having his problems with drinking and with drugs as well throughout his life. And I don't want to say he is not to blame for that, because he had major problems as a young man and got started in that type of a lifestyle, I suppose you would call it. But he was in rehab, and he called, and he got me on the phone this one day and said that he was in rehab, and he was going to get out, and he was not going to come back, and that they were trying to force him to do something that he didn't want to do. And I was like, what is that? He said, they want me to write something. And I said, well, you're the best writer in the world, you know? You know, you wrote Jailbane, for God's sake.
One of his records.
Full of time, you know? So he's like, no, I don't want to write any more songs. I was, what about an autobiography? He's like, no, I don't want to write about myself. And out of somewhere, gospel truth, I just said, what about fiction? And he's paused and, fiction? Okay, you mean make it up? I said, make it up. Yeah. And over a period of time, what evolved into Suites, a short period of time, really, maybe 2 months, he was faxing over, in the days of the fax machine, he was faxing over chicken scrawl over a plot line of what was going to be happening in this book. Mm-hmm. That was a woman's perspective, a woman drug addict who was going to be hustling, amazing tale, and it became Suites.
And this is your first book, the first of the Kix books line.
One of the things that he wanted to have me promise was, he said, if I write this, will you publish it? Mm-hmm. And I said, yes. Mm-hmm. And of course, that had to happen. The evolution of that was that I showed a copy of the manuscript to Nick Tosh's, and Nick freaked out, immediately wanted to have a book of his own on the Kix line. And I also showed it to Harlan Ellison, who was a dear friend, one of my favorite writers from collecting paperbacks. And Harlan said that, you know, you always wanted to republish that one book of mine that's never been republished. Mm-hmm. I want you to do it with Kix books. Mm-hmm. So everything came back. After years and years and years of fandom and collectordom, to create this hip pocket paperback world. I wanted to have paperbacks for everyone.
Yeah. Also, a lot of them had perfume. There's some perfume.
Every one of them had perfume.
Yeah, Suites certainly had perfume. These can all be, by the way, purchased in the back of the library today. Kim Fowley's autobiography, The Poetry of Sun Ra, you put out, and also Of course, books by Royston Ellis, who just passed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You put out a number of his.
Yeah,
like,
and
Royston's
he was
books.
The paperback writer. He truly
That's
was,
right.
as the Beatles would write about him. And he was a close friend of theirs, very influential with them, and also had Jimmy Page as a teenager was the backing musician to his rocketry. And he pretty much invented that whole scene of having poetry recited over or a musical background and rock and roll. So
sounds
God bless
familiar.
Them.
All of these books are available on the website, the Norton Records website. You can read about them. You can find out more about them, as well as all the records that we've just been, the musical artists we've just been talking about. And 10 years ago, you came out with a comic book, sort of. It's called Kicksville Confidential.
Kicksville Confidential. The last copies are available here. That was written entirely by Billy and illustrated by the great Avi Spivak. And Billy tried to pull out all of the stories. We worked together on getting the stories together, but he did all of the writing for the each one of the panels that appears in the comic book. But he tried to tell the story visually and with humor as to where Kicks came from, Norton came from, and all the artists that we ended up working with at Norton called it Kicksville, and Kicksville is the name that has stuck to this day.
Absolutely. I want to talk just for a minute about a book that you co-authored in 2015. Marshall Crenshaw and I were talking about this the other night, about Bobby Fuller. He was part of the El Paso scene, and of course he had the great record, I Fought the Law, and the law won. Bobby Fuller died under very mysterious circumstances. You, in 2015, you put out an autobiography. Just talk a little bit about that.
Well, it was a biography that was co-written with Randy Fuller. Of Bobby's life. And Randy really wanted to stress the early years. And I think that's a major telling with every one of the artists, is those early years are most important to so many of us, because we can relate at that period before, you know, the real creative force explodes in all of them. And and that was important to me. I was a huge Bobby Fuller fan to begin with, and to be able to tell the story with Randy was a great privilege.
Yeah, it's a story that still continues to fascinate to this day any real fan of rock and roll. Is was he murdered? You know, there's just been a lot of speculation about it.
Yeah.
Now, in 2012, we all remember Hurricane Sandy. Some of us, really suffered from that. You guys, more than anyone I know, almost, most of your paper collection went underwater in Hurricane Sandy. Much of it, that was housed in New York.
Well, the books, yes, but the major loss was the records, which was over 250,000 records, and a lot of you know that story. Mm-hmm. We were in Red Hook, Brooklyn, and went under 6.5 feet of water. The paperbacks all went underwater, and so did a lot of the vintage stuff, thousands of vintage paperbacks and files. It's difficult to talk about it.
Yeah, I know.
It's been 10 years, but... Yeah. It's still crazy.
Absolutely, absolutely. We're gonna talk now a little bit about the great Billy Miller. Is that all right? You said to me, Billy passed away in 2016, and you said to me that without question, his first love was the studio. Billy's first love. Going into the studio with different artists.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yeah. He really was most interested in hearing the talent of other people and going into the studio with them. That was his big thrill. And he managed to do that over and over and over again with the older artists. You know, so you're showing Nathaniel there.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
With Andre Williams and Dave Baby Cortez and so many of them. And then other new artists such as... Daddy Long Legs.
Yeah.
He was really thrilled with that. And he wanted to bring the music of young, current artists to the foray as well as the older artists.
Yeah, he was tireless, as are you. And since then, you have not stopped, Miriam. You have continued to create. You've continued to work on the legacy. And one of the most important things that you've done is Billy's book on a Fortune Records, a label out of Detroit, Michigan. that anyone who knows, knows. And if you don't know, you should look it up. They were one of the most unique record labels in all of American pop music history, I think.
Yes.
And Billy started, and you said that at his passing, all you really had were bunches of papers. You know, you didn't have much. How did you turn it into, it's a beautiful book. I saw at least one copy was in the back. And how did you turn it into the beautiful book that it turned out to be? Because it's so gorgeous.
Well, about halfway through his research for it, which was basically trying to unearth the records and gather up the records and try to find the artists and so on, mm-hmm. He began working with the Michael Hurt, who is a really great record person and a very good writer as well. So Michael came in, especially for the hillbilly side of things, because Fortune Records was not just R&B. They were many things. And yeah. One of the great functions of the label was yeah. to deliver some of the greatest rockabilly sides and hillbilly sides to us as well. When Billy passed, he was working, you know, I don't want to get into the detail because it is very depressing.
Right.
But, you know, during those days, he worked till the very last day.
Yes. And it's beautiful. You mentioned you wanted to have the best paper. You wanted to have a beautiful presentation of it. And you have, Miriam. It's just one of the most beautiful tributes I think I've ever seen.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
I have to credit Lenny Kay.
Yes.
Primarily because about a year afterward, you know, he called. Mm-hmm. And
yeah.
he said, what about the Fortune book? And
yeah.
I said, yeah, Lenny, I mean, it's so hard.
Yeah.
He said, anything that I can do.
Of course, of course.
You know, I'll do. And, you know, you've got to do it. You know,
yeah.
he was really, I've never, Lenny's a dear friend, and I know he's a dear friend to you, too. He was never a guy to back off when
right.
he meant something. He wasn't going to say, oh, maybe you should do it or maybe
right.
you shouldn't do it.
Right.
And he was like, you've got to do it. You've got
to right.
do it now. Or what can you do?
Yeah.
You know, anything that I can do to help
yes.
you on that. And it
yeah.
really, you know, I got Mike on the phone and
yeah. Yeah.
and really, you know, really pushed on him
yeah.
To be able to work on his end of things, and we worked on ours, and I got
yeah.
Marc Miller, who had come out of the woodwork after many years,
sure, sure.
To help with the editing on that,
yeah.
and we managed to get it to that point. As fate would have it, and not the greatest of fates, is that the book was completed back from the printer,
right.
right as COVID was hitting.
Yeah.
So, you know, distribution, getting it overseas,
right.
the mailings, everything was like halted at that time.
Mm-hmm.
But you're
mm-hmm.
right, we printed it in Michigan, in Chelsea, Michigan,
mm-hmm.
which, you know, as you
yes,
know, that's
know.
A cub P.O.
Cub
box there.
Yeah.
You know, we printed it in Chelsea, but we didn't want to print it out of the country. We wanted it in Michigan because
yeah.
it's a Michigan mom and pop operation
yeah.
that really brought all this great music to us.
Yes.
So. Yeah, that's
yeah.
basically what happened.
Yeah.
So through the past couple of years, we were never even able to do a proper presentation of the book in Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
We really wanted to do that at one of the Michigan libraries, but everything was closed due to
mm-hmm.
COVID.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were fortunate to get a lot of activity with people enthusing about the book. But we're down to the last copies, so
yes,
we've got a few copies here.
Marshall also told me the other night that Marshall Crenshaw, who's from Detroit, takes this book as his Bible. He said he's read
really?
It numerous times. We're going to feature right now a song that I insisted that we use to show you what Norton Records was all about. I mean, what Fortune Records was all about. Cub Coda introduced me to this song. The great Nolan Strong and the Diablos, Mind Over Matter.
Maybe.
And there's plenty more where that came from. Village of Love by Nathaniel Meyer. It's such a great label. And by the way, never been reissued because Devorah Brown's family just wouldn't go for it, right? So far.
So far, it's only been, put out by, let's call them fan club releases overseas.
Yeah, but no real great bits and snatches.
Never properly compiled, no.
All right, now going over to a man who was very dear to both of us, Dion DiMucci. You put out a record which would never again have seen the light of day called Kicking Child in 2016. With great help from Scott Kempner, of course, from the Del Lords. Billy, this was toward the end of his life, but you tell me you're walking from the hospital one day when you get the call from Dion that who really, for some reason, didn't want the stuff to come out, and although it's gorgeous and beautiful, by Tom Wilson, who, again, Marshall Crenshaw is doing a documentary about Tom Wilson, at the time was working with Bob Dylan, so now he hooks up with Dion, and you get a call when you're walking from the hospital one day from Dion.
Yeah, there was. It actually goes back just a tad before that, when Billy was bedridden at home and wanted to listen to something that he hadn't already heard before, because we're always pulling out records and things for him to listen to. And there was a mixtape CD, whatever they call them these days, that a friend had sent years before, and I was opening the envelope, as I sometimes have mail that doesn't get open for a long time, that was put together by a friend, Phil Milstein, who is a Boston area guy. So at any rate, the first tune that came out of there was a song called Now, and Dion's song Now, and it was so devastating. Mm-hmm. Golly, it was just so heart-wrenching and heart-drenching and significant. At that time, I thought that this Now was really kind of a message from outer space about what was going to happen, and it wasn't going to be good. So I did contact Dion at that time, tried to contact Dion, didn't get through, and went through our friends at Sony. They said, you'll never get it, that he's never going to let you do it, and so on. And then Scott came into the picture. And Scott Kempner, God bless his heart, went to Dion and said, these people are the ones. So credit where credit is due with all of these things, because it's always a group of friends and people who care, who bring it all together, And we ended up issuing that album. It came out posthumously, but put together after Billy passed away. But it's a difficult album for me to listen to even to this day, because of what was going on at that point. Dion became a very close friend because of that. And I remember talking to him about Now, and I said, that album, that song on the album is about death, isn't it? And he said, no, it's not about death at all. It's about life again.
Yes. Yeah.
He is such a philosophical individual. I mean, he really is the great voice of American rock and roll, as you know.
As I know, we both think that he's really the missing link for so many things.
Yes.
All right, we're going to hear now a little bit of the title track, Kickin' Child.
All right.
And this is, again, these are 60s recordings by the Wanderer, Dion DiMucci. Here we go.
Okay.
Yeah.
Dion.
Yeah.
The king of the New York streets. Now, just to say that this is not a woman that lets any, you know, grass grow under her feet, not at all. In December 2022, a few months ago, you decide to launch something called, little thing, called Kicksville Radio.
That's right.
So now she's streaming, she's bad, she's nationwide. You and Marc Miller team up for this really interesting, something called Crashing the Party. Tell us about Crashing the Party.
Well, Crashing the Party was really, it kind of saved my life in a really dark period when, I really didn't know where to go or where to go outside of my home, really. You know, these feelings of loss and so on. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Very difficult.
Yeah.
Music. Always.
Does anybody have a Kleenex? Let's bring some Kleenex up here. Somebody bring one up.
No Kleenex.
All right.
Please.
Okay, never mind. No Kleenex. All right.
You know,
but you go ahead with this, and this gives people a chance who are also isolating, you know, to hear some just fabulous music. I mean, your collection is unbelievable.
Well, it came largely out of the feeling that I felt I was being told that this couldn't happen, that you couldn't do that, that this was unnecessary. And I felt that if you feel something's necessary, you do it. We've been doing it for all these
years. That's your whole life, for Pete's sake.
When people said they didn't give a crap, or wasn't this, it wasn't that, it wasn't glitzy enough, it wasn't this or that, we still did it. So, I've got to thank my friend, Matt Clark, who's out here.
Yeah, baby.
Who really saw that through. He just said, you do it. We'll do it. We'll do it. And so so that came out of a love for the vocal group stuff, and really got the youngest doo-wop fan in America at one point in time, Marc Miller, involved with it. I asked him, I said, will you help with this? He said, I'll absolutely help with this. So so we got moving on that. And from that, it developed into this idea. And again, Matt being very involved with that, thank you, in developing Kicksville as a radio station. He said, you don't have to wait to hear, Kid Thomas or any of this other stuff on the radio. You can deliver it. And so it became, the idea became a kind of an adjunct to Kicks Magazine, Kicks Books, and Norton Records to have 24/7 radio that was trying to bring to light the people who didn't get radio action, who didn't get print action, and who just were not everyday names, to get their music out there 24/7. And that's what we've been doing, and adding music to it day by day. It took a couple years to do, but once it launched, I'm very thrilled with it.
Beautiful.
Miriam, come on.
And Norton Records moves on. This is a group called Les Gris Gris, which I heard about them when you and Howard Thompson were on the radio a couple of weeks ago. This is your new love. They're French.
Oh, yeah. The great French group.
Yeah.
And along with Daddy Long Legs, like the younger segment of this particular type of a sound, it really remarkable, and I enjoy them a lot. I'm glad that you picked something from them.
Oh, I did. They're beautiful. Yeah. Look at them, too. Yeah. It's the Flame and Groovies all over again.
Yes,
you know.
Indeed. You're right there. You're right there.
This is wonderful. And then I want to talk about something very personal to both of us, I know. Last May, we were both at the Celebration of Life in New York City for the great Ronnie Spector.
Yes.
And you created... Yeah, go ahead. Yes, go ahead. I think maybe John Greenfield is here. Yeah, all right. He's over in the corner there. You created, and I found out when someone, I was the MC, and I was honored to be the MC, and someone brought me back one of these. You created a button. This is a button on one of my jackets. You came to the event with all these beautiful buttons of Ronnie. I've not taken it off every time I wear that jacket. And when I was here with Mark Naftalin, the blues show, I wore that. And again, one of the things that this says to me is that your love is not just for the underdog, but it is for someone who was so deeply in the mainstream of American popular music, world popular music, Ronnie Spector, that you would come and pass these out to everyone who was at City Winery that day. Everyone had a close connection to Ronnie. And we just treasure those buttons, you know, in her memory. So thank you.
It was a teenage thing to do.
Yes, it was wonderful, and it's wonderful. And in a moment of synchronicity, we have Ronnie sang something with Andre Williams.
Absolutely. So, Jonathan, you remember that one of the requests was from you, straight from Ronnie, was that, you know, make sure there's candy there. So I went to the store and bought every type of candy that there was in a big basket to make sure that things were sweet.
Well, we have the clip, so this is an Ike and Tina Turner. It's going to work out fine. Let's hear, you know, Ronnie Spector with Andre Williams, and this is really something, let me tell you. Ronnie Spector and Andre Williams, yeah. Well, listen, we're going to circle back one more time now to talk about sort of another one of these synchronicity moments. And you had said to me early on about this love of the underdog. You mentioned that word, and you mentioned it earlier today as well. And I thought of another group, and I know is near and dear to many, you know, New Haven fans especially, that I know you had a very close relationship with, and that is the Fleshtones.
Yes!
So talk about your connection there with them.
Well, I met the Fleshtones early on, playing at CBGB's, and began hanging out with them, and they were the most regular people. They were the most Ohio-type people that were on this side of the Great Divide of Pennsylvania there. So I've been lifelong friends with them, particularly with Peter Zaremba, who is definitely, you know, some kind of a relative of mine that I never knew of. but they're the group that has really stuck to their guns of having fun and making rock and roll all the time and have never let go.
Yeah, yeah. Look, there they are. Yeah. Rock and roll lives there, folks, I have to tell you.
Yeah, they were around through everything, and they just never gave up on their sound and their enjoyment of rock and roll and of life and of the fans, and they treat their fans so well.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Again, I just want to mention for 1 minute this chapbook. I know it's not ready yet, but it's going to be ready.
Yes.
And you'll be selling it. Will it be on the website?
Yes, it will be. You know, I've had a permissions issue that has now been resolved, you know, trying to hunt down exactly who had permissions for the Lester. Mm-hmm. And now I've got their blessing. So I really wanted to include that as you know, it's just like a major focal point, because to me, it's like it's the promise of the future for rock and roll and for what you feel about music, to make sure that you do exactly what you want to do and say what you want to do, and don't try to please other people. Please the history that you respect.
That's right. And isn't that the essence of the underdog, really?
Yes. It is. They're always right, you know? Yeah. I don't mind.
Yeah. You know, I think everybody in this room today, if you weren't you wouldn't be in this room if you weren't knowledgeable about the fact that the undercurrent of popular music has always been every bit as interesting as the top level. It's always been every bit as interesting as the superstar level. But without Norton Records, without Kicks Books, without Kicks Magazine, so many of these artists would not have had a viable platform, really. As a historian, I can't begin to tell you how important that is to me, and I think it is to everybody in this room as well. Am I right? Yeah. We're almost at the end, but I'm gonna just bother you one more time here. You have said, I was always waiting for something to happen, looking for something that I didn't know anything about. I was born curious. As a child, I dreamed about the pyramids and about living in a haunted library.
That's right.
And here we are, in a library.
I have a passion for libraries, and I have a passion for books. I'm a big book collector, paperbacks particularly, magazines, and all the rock and roll stuff. Anything that was written about rock and roll, especially the early stuff, as early as possible, when that actual rock and roll bent came into it, is very important to me, because that's topical. It was pulp. It was not intended to last the ages. Rock and roll wasn't intended to last the ages, but it has, and will forever. Yeah. So libraries, you know, coming into a library like this, it's astonishing to see that this stage here and a screen and music available and studios and the emphasis on, you know, bringing music in with the written word. Because I remember being a little student librarian myself, and it was like, you know, turn that transistor radio off, and shh, you know. it was something very, very different. So I think that's where the world might be going, and I'm looking forward to being able to contribute in some way with our own personal archive to making that history survive. And it's a lot of fun. It's always been fun. Yeah. And if life isn't fun, then you're doing the wrong thing.
That's right. But you also have, of course, one of the biggest archives of paperback JD books, juvenile delinquent books especially.
Yeah.
You had a whole series called Bad Seed, which came out. And so you are really keeping the flame burning there as well, with just collecting in an archival kind of way.
Oh, very much so. You know, in the paperback world, they collect 1939 to 1959 particularly.
Yeah.
Some things afterward, but that's my period, because I got to know many of the authors and publishers during that period. And of course, that's the whole thing, you know. I mean, you know, I think about being on the other side of the, you know, whatever barometer of life that we have. And it's so important.
Yeah.
To keep it.
Yes.
Remember.
Yeah, absolutely.
You don't want music and the history of these people to be forgotten.
Absolutely not. And just to say one more time about the website, the Bad Seed part of the website is by far one of the most interesting parts. Bad Seed had perfume, it had a postcard book, which I'm proud to own, it had t-shirts, and these were all great juvenile delinquent, you know, book covers. And, very, very kitschy, very fabulous to have, you know, for those fashionistas.
The whole thing with the paperbacks and the books and the writers of that period is that it was involved with the rock and roll era. Yeah. So it all bled into each other. You know, you look at the whole appearance, the whole look, the whole attitude of the people who were being written about. So I don't want people to forget that. No. You know, I want them to be able to read that, and being able to reissue, collect, and put new fiction out and new authentic nonfiction. Is very important.
Huge.
Let's keep the history going. And you know, these are the people that, you know, everybody wants to read another Elvis bio. Great.
Yeah.
Keep it going.
Exactly.
There's a little realm over here with a whole ton of other talented people who went through a lot of struggle and made great records. Let's talk about them.
Yeah, exactly. I think we would all agree that you, with Billy, created your own library, and it's far from haunted. It's vibrant and so alive and so inclusive. And we all have benefited. For your dedication, for your enthusiasm, and your constant pushing of the envelope, we thank you. Please stand to celebrate the rock and roll tenacity and brilliance of Miriam Linna. Oh,
thank you so much. Oh, boy. Thank you, Christine.
Oh, look. Oh, my God, look. Oh. It's so important that you're all here today. Thank you. We have time for just a few questions.